This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm Doyle Davidson, servant apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas, Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to deliver unto you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4 tell us what the gospel is. That Jesus Christ died for our sins, according to Scripture, he was buried, and he rose again the third day, according to the Scripture. Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He said, anointed me to preach gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the broken heart, preach deliverance to the captives, give sight to the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. Word is thy. And in heart and your mouth is a word of faith. So I preach, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God raised you from the dead, you shall be saved. With the heart, by believing unto righteousness, with the man believing unto salvation. Thank God. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. There's the power of God unto salvation. Everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and to the Greek also. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by his faith. I want to welcome everyone receiving this broadcast on live stream. Thank God, Roku, Apple TV, YouTube, and other devices. Thank God. Hallelujah. Amen. To my right, co-host Terre Brown. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm well, thank
Great.
You.
And to my left, co-host Kathy Davidson. How are you?
Good morning. I'm doing well, and you're fired up.
I'm full of faith.
Yeah.
And I've got a war on my hands. I've got somebody lying to me about money, and don't believe him. He's lying. Don't believe him, Terry. Don't believe him.
Amen.
I didn't mean to tell the world, but Kathy said, I'm fired up. Look, you lay down, and the devil eats your lunch.
Amen.
So use your faith and act like somebody. Not talking to you, talking to everybody. Amen. Did we get you, Katie?
Yeah, and you kind of threw in Anthony there in the middle. Yeah. So, I said, and you threw Anthony there in the middle.
We introduced you.
Right, but we still need to get the courier.
Oh, Anthony get in?
Yeah, you got him in, didn't you?
No,
he didn't? Oh, okay, I heard your name. I'm
would
sorry.
Would you let me do this program? To my brother, to my left, amen. Apostle, amen. Anthony Reese, co-host, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. And then, to my right on the wire, from Colorado, Kathy Courier. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Amen. And you're all ready to do some reading for us?
I am.
Well,
amen.
In a little bit. It's a time to get the Mai Girls here and stir up our faith.
Amen.
Let's bring them on. Mercy, grace, amen. Hallelujah. Thank God. The devil's mad and I'm happy. Well, I'm not afraid of the devil.
Amen.
I woke up 3 o'clock one morning and he was standing by my pillow. I didn't know it and I walked right into him and turned and went the other way. When I got back, he was gone.
Amen.
That's how scared I am of the devil.
Amen.
Amen. People say, oh, the devil's about to get me. No, he's got you. Use your faith.
Amen.
Don't be afraid.
Amen.
Thank God.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Amen.
You don't know what this world's like, folks. But you may find out, huh?
Amen.
Amen. Okay, Katie.
Yes, sir.
What are we going to do?
Well, you talked to Kathy Currier this morning.
Well, okay, I'll go. In 2003, the Lord sent me to America to pray. Amen. To pray for every state. Amen. Every state. We flew a corporate jet. 7 of us went and prayed. And we started the obedience to God July the 11th. Amen. Now, have you got, who's got, where all the places I went to pray, up to Plymouth. All right? Would you read it?
Yep.
Oh,
okay. You want me to?
Sure.
July 11th was Joplin, Missouri. July 18th was Tulsa, Oklahoma. July 26th was Ontario, California. August 1st was Houston, Texas. August 22nd was Lafayette, Louisiana. September 5th was Byers, Colorado. September 12th was Nashville, Tennessee. September 19th was Milwaukee, Wisconsin. October 3rd, Dublin, Virginia. October 10th, Charlotte, North Carolina. October 17th, Russell, Kansas. October 23rd was Waterville, Maine. October 24th was Mansfield, Ohio. November 21st was Washington, D.C. and also Baltimore, Maryland. And then November 28th was Plymouth, Massachusetts and Providence, Rhode Island.
Hallelujah. Now, we've been all those places praying. However, God had us pray in all the cities of America, and it brought us to Dublin, Virginia, where the Davidsons were. They came in there. That happens to be who I am, a Davidson. But I also am a Miller. My mother was a Miller. The Davidsons of my dad. So when we get to Dublin, we leave there, pardon me, we're going now to Plymouth, Mass. But we had an amazing story I told yesterday. You can get that. Go back and listen, folks. This is God in my life moving throughout America after, what, 16 years?
Amen.
Amen. Again, we're talking about it. Now, we ended up in Rhode Island. We went to Plymouth. We came back to Rhode Island, to the founders of Rhode Island. I did not know anything about my ancestors being in Rhode Island. I knew that Davidsons were in Virginia. I knew that. That my great-grandfather was there and left and moved to Illinois. Name was Golden Davidson. Amen. But now we find out that Rhode Island had 8 of my great-great-grandfathers that ministered in Rhode Island, founded Rhode Island. Amen. Thank God. Amen. There are 8 of them that I believe came from England. And my great-grandfather, Newell Miller, was a private to a sergeant in the cavalry of the Civil War. He got out as a sergeant in Georgia and moved to Missouri. Amen. Now, I find out something that I said the last Sunday of 08, last Sunday of June 08, that my ancestors came to the U.S. so I could preach the gospel. I didn't know any of that. But guess what? I've been preaching the gospel to America since 19. Well, I really started in 1974. But then my ministry was established in this building, January 4th, 1980. I've been on television 26 years, and shortwave radio, and now we find that we're related to 8 ministers, great-grandfathers from England. Catherine Currier is going to read something that's, I believe it's posted on my, Rhode Island Founders?
That's correct.
Okay. Here's Catherine Currier from Colorado on the wire. Good morning.
This is an introduction on our Rhode Island page, and I'm just going to read most of it. Rhode Island was founded on the idea that government did not have the authority to dictate men's conscience, that no king could be head of the church except the King of Kings, Jesus Christ.
Wow.
The Englishmen who settled Rhode Island had came to America seeking the freedom to worship God and obey the scriptures as they understood them. The separatists, and they were later called Pilgrims, came to America on the Mayflower in 1620 and founded Plymouth Colony. 10 years later, the Puritans followed, and it was a large wave of them arriving in the 1630, and they established Massachusetts Bay Colony. The Pilgrims believed it necessary to separate from the Church of England. The Puritans believed the Church of England could be reformed or purified from within. They all had left England seeking freedom of religion and worship. Around 1636, other separatists began to arrive at Boston, determining to settle in Boston or Salem, which were both of Massachusetts Bay Colony. Upon their arrival, they have found the Puritan rulers had established over the colony a new church government as strict and severe as the one they had left in England. Those who didn't agree with the governing authorities lost all privileges as citizens to vote or own land. The Freeman's Oath had been changed from the government of King Charles and was now to the government of Massachusetts. Magistrates were empowered to fine or imprison all persons that didn't attend their church meetings, and not one could be admitted to the freedom of the Commonwealth who gathered in any other church meeting. No one could inhabit the colony without being examined and licensed by the magistrates, and anyone who settled in violation of these laws were commanded to leave. The orders were enforced, and those who didn't conform often faced severe penalties, jail, public whippings, and even death. There were many who, for conscience' sake, would not conform to those rules and were banished from Massachusetts Bay Colony. They made their way into the Narragansett Indian Territory, which we now know as Rhode Island. With great trials and persecutions, they founded the Sixth Principal Church and established a civil government that was separate from the church. Many of them served as ministers and elders of the churches they established, and a recorded deed in 1711 listed the church at Providence as a Six Principles church, and those six principles are the foundation teachings found in Hebrews 6:2. In June 2008, which Joel previously mentioned, and by the Spirit of God, God said, God sent my ancestors to America so I could preach the gospel. Since that time, he has learned that he traces his maternal ancestors to this group of men who founded Rhode Island, as does also David Casbright. These are the men that Dole has in his maternal heritage: Stukely Westcott, Ezekiel Holloman, John Warner, Samuel Gorton, Obadiah Holmes, Chad Brown are both Dole and David's ancestors. Dole also traces his lineage to John Coggeshall and John Green of Quidnacet, which is not the surgeon John Green that we read about. And David also has others that he traces his to. Ezekiel Holloman and Stukely Westcott were part of the original group that Roger Williams invited to join him. And Ezekiel Holloman, of course, is the one who baptized Roger Williams. And then Roger Williams baptized the others, which was Stukely Westcott, and I understand also his, at least his wife, I don't know about his children. And then later, there were others who came and joined Roger Williams, and Chad Brown was one of those. And when Roger Williams left the church, as we've discussed earlier, Chad Brown took over that ministry, and he ministered there until his death. And one of the final things that I just wanted to read was, in studying the history of the founding of Rhode Island, it is evident that had not God upheld them, this group of men, the United States of America would be a very different country. The influence these men and others with them had on this nation was described by one historian as that it operated like leaven in diffusing itself through the minds of the masses and formed the nucleus out of which ultimately sprang the Declaration of Independence. And research, what we're finding, research continues to confirm the words that Doyle spoke that day in June. They came so he could preach the gospel. Amen.
Amen.
I just want to put in this with here, with this Rhode Island, when we had the Constitutional Convention and our Constitution was drawn up, all nine colonies had to agree to it so that it would be implemented, and Rhode Island held out. They said they would not. They were the first colony to be able to vote, but they held out to the last on the claim that they would not okay the Constitution until the Constitution had a Bill of Rights.
Bill of Constitution what?
Had a Bill of Rights.
A Bill of Rights.
That Rhode Island would not sign off on the Constitution until it had the Bill of Rights. And that is what Kathy was referring to, that nucleus that caused this nation to be a nation of free people that governed themselves.
You know why Rhode Island could stand that way? God.
Amen.
Our ancestors, preachers, ministers, the Word of God.
Amen.
The Mayflower.
Amen.
Standing in that area. You see, folks, God brought everything to His attention. This land belongs to God.
Amen.
It belongs to God. It does not belong to any man.
Amen.
I think it's Psalm 24:1 says, "The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof."
Amen.
"And all of the inhabitants there."
Amen.
So nobody owns anything but God.
Amen.
We've got deeds. The land says we own it, but God owns it.
Amen.
Amen.
And let me tell you, folks, God is going to exercise His right as the creator of the universe.
Amen.
His Son, Jesus Christ, created everything. Anthony, would you read, I believe, Colossians 1, is it?
Yes.
What Jesus created?
Yes.
Before He was Jesus.
Yes.
He was the Son of God. Okay?
Yes. It says in verse 16 of Colossians chapter 1, "For by Him," and that's Jesus, "were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by Him and for Him, and He is before all things, and by Him all things consist."
Amen. And there's more?
Yes. We can go on here. It says, "And He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have the preeminence."
Amen.
"For it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself, by Him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath He reconciled in the body of His flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in His sight, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister."
Hi, Kathy. Kathy D?
Yes, sir.
Would you turn to John chapter 1, verse 1?
Sure will.
And read about 15 or 16 verses about the Son of God.
Amen.
Before He became Jesus.
Amen.
Right?
Amen. Amen.
Would you read it?
Sure will. Verse 1. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not."
Well, just a minute. Who wrote that book?
The Apostle John.
The Apostle John. One of the 12 apostles.
Amen.
Of Jesus, right?
That's right.
All right, now would you go on?
Verse 6. "There was a man sent from God, his name was John. He came for a witness, to bear witness of that light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came into his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor the will of flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth."
The Word was made flesh.
Amen.
The Word is the Lord.
Amen.
Right?
Jesus.
Jesus. Amen. Thank God. Now, what time is it?
It is 10:28.
10:28? Thank God. Amen. 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 Kathy Currier, are you there?
I am.
Newell Miller has three grandsons, right?
Yes. Yes.
Paul Miller, Malloy Miller, and Doyle Davidson.
Amen.
Is that right?
That's correct.
Paul Miller was a journalist, a very strong journalist, important what he did, and was, I believe, president, maybe owner of Gannett newspaper. Is that right?
That's correct. President or chairman. He was also president and chairman, I believe, of the Associated Press. And then after that, he was one of the main, he might have been chairman or president of Gannett. I'd have to go back and double check that.
Hey, Ben. Played golf with Nixon. President Nixon. He was well known in Washington. Well accepted by some people. He happened to be my cousin. Second cousin, right? Then Malloy. I never knew Paul, but I knew Malloy. He would come by the house to see my mother. He was always in a hurry. And he'd get out of the car. Hello, Doyle. Go talk to mother. Come back, get in his car, leave. Amen. He was on the staff, I believe, of the University East Coast. You remember what it was?
Boston.
Huh?
Boston University.
What university?
Boston.
Boston University. Amen. Amen. Thank God. Amen. Of course, I rebelled against God in 1958. He told me not to be a veterinarian, but a minister of the gospel, and I couldn't do it. I believe he told me that later. I went ahead and became a veterinarian, and in 1969, he visited me and said, sell everything and obey me. 1970, that's what I've been doing since January the 2nd, 1970. Preaching the gospel. Amen. We three were what? Cousins?
That would be correct. Like second or third cousins?
We were what?
Like second or third cousins?
Right. Amen. Of Newell Miller. Right?
Correct.
Amen. What do we do next?
Well, I could say something about the Davidson side.
Well, let's do it.
Because we found... You say, well, why is this important? Well, this is how our nation was founded, and this is how our nation became a nation under God. The Davidson's name, you can find the Davidson name in Scotland in the 1300s. And in the 1500s in Scotland, they had what they called the Covenanters. And what the Covenanters did was, as we shared before, Martin Luther is the one that was the first one to stand up and say that the Catholic Church had it wrong, that the Word of God took preeminence over any other doctrine. And he took that Bible and he translated it in German. And when he translated, when Martin Luther translated the Bible into German, then a whole lot of Germans could read the Bible. And when they started reading the Bible, they realized that their religion that they were brought up under was wrong. And that's when a lot of conflict and a lot of wars took place. And one of the places that happened to, and it just didn't happen in Germany, and it didn't happen with one man going to another area and starting it there, and then another man going to another area. It was simultaneously a move of the Spirit. And that move of the Spirit was in Scotland. And they, too, translated the Bible into what they could read, into English and Scottish. And the Covenanters came out and said, we cannot be under the Pope any longer. And they coveted together and took an oath saying that the Pope was not their Pope, was not their leader, and that they had no other leader but Jesus. And some of those men signed that those covenants, there's more than one, those covenants with their own blood, knowing that when they signed their name, they were up for excommunication and to be killed, to be murdered. And yet they still did it. And that spirit in the Scots, we call the Presbyterian Church, which was one of the first Protestant church, along with the Lutherans. The Lutherans were under Luther.
Amen.
You had the Presbyterians, you had the Luthers, then you had the Mennonites, and you had some of the others. Those are the people that came to the United States first. And the reason they came to the United States first was because they wanted to follow the Word of God like they read it. As Currier said, to follow their own conscience and what their conscience read in the Word of God. And that's how the United States got started. So not only was it the Miller side of the family and my dad's side of the family that came over as pilgrims, but it was also the Scottish people that came over. We had a large group of Scots over here. In fact, when it was time to go against England and to get rid of King James, the Scots were the first ones to say, sign me up. Where do I go? Who do I fight? So there were them. They were the separatists from England. All of those groups were from a basic group of Protestants that said that they could no longer be under the Roman Catholic Church and they could no longer be under the Anglican Church, which was very similar, that they had to follow their conscience and follow the Word of God.
Amen. You know, the Davidsons were Northern Methodists.
Amen.
And they didn't believe anything. And they said so. They said so. But James Madison Davidson, my great-grandfather,
amen,
an owner of quite a bit of land, a fruit grower, a cattleman, a house builder, a house mover, moved from Illinois to Missouri in 1870 and settled on land just on the west side of Circoxy.
Amen.
Amen. On what was at that time Joplin Street, just to the south of it.
Amen.
And very successful, prosperous. And in 1911, James Madison drove a rusty nail into his foot and got tetanus and died. After tetanus began, the symptoms, he died in 7 days. That's all recorded and witnessed by Dr. John Boyd. John Boyd was known by the Davidsons very well. I did not know him, but Dr. Simmons replaced him and was in his office on Center Hill by the railroad track. And Dr. Simmons treated me when I had diphtheria.
Amen.
And just a kid, little boy, I visited him how many days and had an injection where it hurt. Thank God. But anyway, James Madison died of tetanus. And believe me, that bunch of Northern Methodists became believers of Jesus Christ.
There is a verse in the Psalms that always remind me of James Madison Davidson. It's in Psalm 119, verse 71. It is good for me that I had been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes. If James Madison Davidson had not died of tetanus, you would have had a whole family that would have not been born again.
And James Madison's death really affected every one of them. But you want something that I didn't know, and I know now. James Madison had sold half of his farm to a man named Grebe, and I knew him, that guy, sold his, and was living with my grandfather,
Amen.
Luther Albert Davidson. And it affected all of Luke's children.
Amen.
Granddad died August 46, shocked every one of us. Amen. He was a road contractor, very well-to-do, had, 58 horses working on in Rolla, Missouri, which was part of, turned in 2 years after he left it to be U.S. 66.
You know, if you think about it, if your grandfather, Luther Albert Davidson, had not died, you would have not left the Redwood Church.
That's right. I tell you, what's even more amazing, in 89, I think it was, 88, somewhere in there, before 92, there was a man named Benjamin Young, a Methodist, got born again. Amazing story. Amazing story.
You're talking about 18...
1888,
right. Just
want
to clarify that.
Back it up there.
Well, didn't I say that?
No, you just said 89 or 92, before 92.
1892. Thank you, girls. You see, I've got all kinds of people watching me because I can't read. I can read, but I can't see to read and haven't been able to since, what year was that? Starting in the December of 808, right?
Amen.
Amen. Thank God. Anyway, it's been an amazing thing. And these Methodists all became John Wesley, believers of John Wesley's teachings. Then, as a child, in the 1880s or 90s, a man named, a family named Parham moved from Iowa to Kansas.
Amen.
Near a university, and a son named Charles Parham got involved with the people that were holiness.
Amen.
And Wesley's teachings ended up in Topeka, Kansas.
Amen.
Right?
That's right.
And had a Bible school there, didn't he?
Yes.
And taught. And I think a group of people with him started fasting.
And praying.
Huh?
And praying.
And praying. Right. That was before when? January?
Yes.
1900?
It was around Christmas time that Charles Parham gave his Bible school an assignment. And he said over that Christmas break, they were to read and pray about Acts 2. And the Holy Ghost breaking out on the apostles and onward. And he wanted them to study, to pray, and have them come back and say what they thought about it, what they considered. And when they came back, they realized that that was something that they could have, or they believed it was something that they could attain.
Amen. And what happened?
January 1st, the first person at the school started speaking in tongues.
Amen. A woman.
A woman.
Right?
She asked for them to lay their hands on her. And when they did, she could speak in tongues.
Amen. Then Barham later moved down the state line, ended up in Galena, Kansas. But I think first he was in Alabama Springs, and a woman from Galena, a wealthy woman, went to his meeting, and she got healed.
Right.
And then Parham came back to Galena and ministered there nearly a year.
Is that right, Kathy? Do you have that in front of you?
I do have that. She was healed, what our research shows, she was healed August 17th, 1903. And she went back and told her husband and friends, and they arranged for Parham to come to Galena to minister. In September 1903, we found an ad in the Galena Evening News, and he ministered there from 1903. I don't have it right in front of me. He started ministering there in 1903, and it was for about a year that he held meetings there.
Then he went to Baxter Springs. And then I believe he went to Houston.
Yes.
And
yes,
told some people in Houston to go to Azusa Street, right?
Amen.
Or Los Angeles.
Right.
Is that right?
Correct.
I believe it's right. I trust my memory. You know, I have a schoolmate that lives in Galena, that same age I am, about a month and a few days younger, that God has promised me he will turn her around and bring her to me, and she will be my friend again. Amen. So there's a lot of history in Joplin, Baxter, Galena. Amen. Where do we go from here? Los Angeles, huh?
There you go.
Amen.
Parham sent... Who is the gentleman that Parham sent?
Seymour,
an African American,
right,
that was with Parham's ministry, and he sent him to Los Angeles.
Right.
And at that time, from what I remember reading, they were already praying in Los Angeles for the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Right. And they asked God, send us someone that can help us. And that's when Seymour came, and then the Holy Ghost, with the evidence of speaking in tongues, broke out in Azusa Street. And that was 1903, correct?
Where?
In Azusa Street.
No, six.
Six, okay.
1906. After, we got a church, Water Black Church of Los Angeles, being formed right now.
Amen.
And it's in that very area, near Azusa Street.
Amen.
Amen. This is a great blessing. You know what blesses me? I didn't know any of this, but Parham's family moved to southern Kansas, and that's not too far from Independence.
Amen.
Where Benjamin Young lived, that area, and Parham was involved from what I can understand the homeless movement.
Right. He spent some time in it.
Right.
And it's amazing that there was obviously a spirit of revival in that area.
Right.
And, you know, it coincides with your great-grandfather dying, but also Benjamin Young and that whole area, Parham. That all happened in the late 1800s and early 1900s.
That's right. Then, you know, what amazes me, there was a man named Bagby. I knew who he was, saw him when I was a young boy. And I think he died in 36. But he came from Kansas to Rhodes, Missouri. Rhodes is a little town west of Circoxy and north, across Center Creek near the railroad track, for those of you that know Rhodes. And there was a revival there. And from what I could understand, Aunt Neva attended that revival and got born again.
Amen. And she was the first one of the Davidsons to be born again, right?
Oh, yes. And she was the oldest, 12 years older than Dad. And she comes back and starts preaching. her name was Neva Dodson, her husband, Claude. Claude died at age 100. I knew them both well. And Neva died, I think she was 70-something.
And she was the one that got the Davidson family into the holiness movement, wasn't she? Or began to.
Yes, yeah. Definitely. Now, when Elliot Hodge.
Right.
Got his arm almost, well.
It was amputated.
Amputated. He went to a Catholic hospital in Pittsburgh, Kansas. And they brought Nellie Johnson at Neva, a preacher named McIntyre, and
Luther. Luther.
Well, Luther and Floyd came
right.
A couple of days later, or three, whatever, and apparently either Floyd or Luther gave blood to Elliot Hodge. And the way it sounds, it was Granddad, okay. Luther. And that's when one of them, it was Granddad, said, about being brothers.
Yeah, we're blood brothers
blood
now.
Blood brothers, yeah.
Right.
So it's been great knowing my history and what God did and what God is doing with Water of Life Church in Plano, Texas, what he started, amen, in 1980, when he told me to go speak to people in Plano and ask him what I say. And he said, read Acts 13, where Paul and Barnabas were at Antioch, you'll understand. You need to read my website, and you can find out where I came from and how who I've been associated with. And today, the Lord himself said on May 22nd, 17, that he chose me and sent me to the four corners of the earth as to deliver his word and to be not without fear and despair. Sent as an apostle and prophet. Amen. So I wasn't sent by a board. I wasn't sent by a church. I was sent by Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. What time is it?
It is 10:53.
10:53.
Amen.
I'd like just to put a note in here. You just commented about the Lord putting together Water of Life, describing right. your ancestors and everything.
Right.
Well, as Kathy shared about your ancestors, the Davidsons coming, being Scots, I've traced my ancestors back to that same group of Scots, and they came here to America just shortly after the Pilgrims arrived in the 1600s. But I've traced my ancestors back to that same group of Scots that actually part of them migrated to Ireland for freedom of worship. So that's when they got labeled the Scots-Irish. But that I've traced my ancestors back there as well. And then God...
Your mother?
My mother's side of the family, yes.
Right.
Yes.
And her grandfather was a circuit riding
yes.
Methodist preacher, right?
That's correct.
Amen.
Yes.
Go ahead.
And then in just a few months before God sent you to Plano to speak to the people of Plano, Steve and I were living in Dallas, and we bought our house in Plano, our first house we bought in Plano, just months before God sent you to speak to the people of Plano.
Amen.
So I've always found it interesting that God moved us here, because we actually had declared that we would never move that far out of town from where our jobs were.
Amen.
And our families. But God raised up this house that we purchased. So God had me here just shortly before he sent you here to Plano to speak to the people of Plano, which included me.
Are you finished?
I'm finished.
Guess what? In the 92, God sent me to Joplin Television.
Amen.
And Tulsa, Oklahoma Television. And there, one day, Anthony, you tell it.
Yeah. Well, one day, somebody had given me two tapes of yours. That was 1994. And the first one was Heroes Again, which actually we're translating the book Heroes Again into other languages. And we've got one shortly to come out, the first one, I believe, being in Spanish. But somebody gave me two tapes, Heroes Again and The Gospel is Always a Blessing. And I started listening to those two tapes. And that's where I first heard the gospel defined out of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 3 and 4 is how that Jesus died for my sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and he rose again the third day. But the important part of that was that what we also saw in Romans, and that is the power of God to salvation. And so I first heard that on those two tapes, and I began listening. There were other guys that at a place where I was going at that time who had listened to you on TV and had already been receiving those tapes. I did not know that at the time. But God had directed me to go to this place. I woke up one morning and I said, you know what? I need to go to church. And I believed that's where I needed to go.
Amen.
And I'd went there for a few years. And I'd been listening to these tapes. And eventually I went and talked to the person that was the pastor over that place. And he said, you need to talk to this other guy here. And so I said, okay. So I went to talk to him. And when I was talking to him, he started off. He said, okay, I'm going to start you with right here. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And so we started there. And he began reading. This is how God brought me to Water of Life Ministry.
Amen.
And so I started, he started reading, and he went through 1 Corinthians. He went through Romans. He went through some other things and how Jesus first began his ministry with saying, repent ye and believe the gospel. And I said, wait a second. Do you know a guy named Doyle Davidson? And he said, that's where this came from. And I said, well, I've been listening to his tapes. Somebody else had given me his tapes. And I've been listening to those. And he said, well, he's on television. And I said, he is? Well, this guy had been listening to you since 92, I guess, when you first got on television in Tulsa.
Right.
And KWHB TV 47. And so I started watching you on TV. You came on. Actually, you came on sometime maybe around midnight on Saturday morning to Sunday evening. And I recorded that one. That way I would have it before the program actually came on later on Sunday evening. And so that's when I first started watching you on television. And you at some point, that was 94. And at 96 is when you came to the Tulsa Marriott. That's the first time I met you. You had a meeting there. I don't know that I actually met you in person at that time, but you had a meeting there on Thanksgiving Day. Me and my brother and several others that attended at that place, we attended that meeting. Amen. And we were there for the meetings to follow. But I continued on coming up to the Gospel Crusades once a month. I would put in my time when I worked at Walmart, and I said, I need off on this Friday. I will be going to a Gospel Crusade. And they said, here you go. Here's your time off. And so I met you up there in Tulsa at the Marriott. And the interesting thing was many times you hosted a breakfast at that time on the Friday mornings. And many times I found myself at the same table as you. And we would be talking. Later on, I want to say this was around 2006, 2005, 2006, you would be having meetings at the Marriott. And as you were walking around out in the area outside the room, I would be walking out there and I would see you coming. And you'd come up to me at one point and said, and mentioned to me about having meetings. I didn't want to have anything to do with speaking in front of anybody. So at that point, from then on, when you would come up there, I would see you coming and I would walk the other direction. You'd come over here and I'd walk this way. So you'd come over there and I'd walk this other way. At one point, I went to the restroom, and as I'm walking out, I opened the door and you're standing there. And you said, do you think you could have a meeting? And I said, yeah, I can do that. And you said, well, let's pray it through. Let's pray about it. And I said, okay. But it wasn't too long after that, in November 2006, you said, I'm going to put you over. Actually, you asked me to start speaking. November 2006. And by December 10th of 2006, you said, I'm going to put you over that group up there in Oklahoma. And so that's how God brought me into the ministry, and here we are here today. We moved here in 2014, God knowing the times and bounds of our habitation, and here we are.
Amen, Andy. You know, that Thanksgiving, 375 people came to that, $20 a plate. I paid for it.
Amen.
We were there.
Huh?
Terre Brown's family was there.
Right, we were there.
Were you there?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Okay. You know what Lester Summerall said when he heard that? Hope no man ever done this. I said, well, Lester, this man has. God sent me. Lester and I became good friends. We talked frequently about some problems in the body of Christ.
Amen.
What time is it?
It is 11:01.
Oh, well, to go back, Terry, Anthony, Katie, God put us all four together.
Amen.
And I'll second Anthony. I had no desire to speak publicly in front of anybody, even a small group. I had less than a small desire, like I did, not want to, terrified of public speaking. Boy, has God changed us, Anthony, right?
Yes.
But you could sing.
In the shower. I didn't sing for anybody publicly.
You could sing, lady.
Well, with the group. I did not sing solo.
Okay, let's prove it. David, could we get her on recording doing I Have Returned?
I have returned to the God of my childhood, to the same simple as a child I once knew. Like the prodigal son, I've longed for my loved ones, for the comforts of home,
the God I outgrew. For the child of her heart, he said, bring them up in the way that you want them. Thank God when they're grown, they'll never depart. I have returned to the God of my mother. I learned at her knee, he's the lily of the valley, he's Jesus to me, my Lord for eternity. Oh, praise his name, I have returned,
I have returned,
I have returned to the God of my father, the most God-like man a child could know. I just heard a shout from the angels in glory, praising the Lord, a child has come home.
Love them.
that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain.
One more. Can't let this one get by. Terre Brown. What's that? One day.
I'm only human. I'm just a woman, help me believe in what I can be and all that I am. Show me the stairway I have to climb. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time. Sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking for. to do everything that I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. Do you remember when you walked among men? Jesus, you know when you're looking below, it's worse now than then. Cheating and stealing, violence and crime. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day. Give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. I'm asking from you, just give me the strength to do every day what you have me do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. Lord, help me today, show me your way, one day at a time.
On Radio 1974. Sung by a country western singer. I don't have time to tell you the story, but someday you'll get to hear it. What time is it?
It is 11:16.
11:15?
16.
Let's have Chico finish it.
Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Satan's like a roaring lion, roaming to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. The Bible tells me so. Many souls have been his prey, caught in some weak hour. But God has given us today his overcoming power. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. On that day of Pentecost, a mighty rushing wind blew into the upper room to baptize all of them with a power greater than anyone had known. And I'm so glad we got it too. I wanna tell the whole wide world. Now tell them with me. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. God is greater than the wisest man. Greater than the power of sin. Greater than the gates of hell. Greater than anyone can tell. Greater than the richest king. Greater than anything. Greater, oh, greater, greater, yes, greater. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world.
Holiday, a friend. Father, thank you. Jesus, thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done for water of life and the world. Amen. Mercy, grace, mercy, grace, mercy, grace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you. See you tonight at 7.
Amen.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.